Developing Our Math Minds is a series of conversations and resources about math that is intended to be a journey of growth for families over several weeks. Each week, Minds lead mathematician and product director Brandon Smith and content development manager Nina Wu will be talking about the adjustments families are making to learning at home and the opportunities this situation provides for changing our relationship with math.
Because we're in this untraditional format of learning, now is a time where things can really be interdisciplinary. Like, math doesn't exist in a vacuum. English doesn't exist in a vacuum. History doesn't exist in a vacuum. Like, all those things are in play, speaking to one another all the time, because we are living in our real worlds. Like, you know how in math class they're like, okay, when you take this home and like go back to the real world, you'll see, you know, math or whatever. Like, we are in our homes and in our worlds right
now. We're
in
it now.
Yeah. And so I think, as you know, a pointer for families is that, like, how can you see learning across different situations? Like, you know, while you're cooking, it's, you know, probably it's math, it's, you know, food knowledge, and maybe some history, like family history and culture. It's like all those disciplines in action together. Or like when you're reading the news or something, like, you know, that's literacy and numeracy and like all these things. And so I think there's a lot of opportunity. There's learning everywhere all around us. And so I think if you can treat and like send home this message as a family, that like everything is connected and a learning opportunity, that'll be a really rich experience. And it'll also take off some pressure from like the academic pressure of like, oh, we need to get in all this time for school. I'm afraid of, you know, my child sliding back. But if everything is treated as a learning opportunity without being annoying or like feeling like medicine, like that'll be a really rich learning experience for students. And it's the right mentality.
Yeah. You know? That's a really good point.
Yeah.
There's value in focus. Like it is, there is a time where you say, hey, like we're working on science or history. Yeah. We do want to focus. That productive struggle does require some level of sustained effort and engagement. It's why, like with SD Math, we always say 30 or 45 minutes, 2 to 3 times a week. So you get 90 minutes, but you're engaged long enough for that productive struggle to really manifest itself in sticky learning. So that focus is good, I think. But there's also, there's no reason right now that we have to completely compartmentalize to some absurd point.
Yeah,
it's good to focus, but it's also good to intermix. I think the key, though, is whatever it is that you're doing, you don't want people to intermix. I just like throwing stuff all over the place or 5 minutes of engagement here,
right
there.
Yeah.
The learning requires some sustained effort in that productive struggle.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Focus time, but also, you know, reminding ourselves to like bring in some ease and not put all this pressure on our students, where they have to do like 8 hours of school a day or whatever. But like, yeah, I think, you know, 30-minute chunks of sustained engagement, and then taking breaks is really important. Children are children.
Teach.
Yeah, and I think encouraging them to, like, get some fresh air, get some sun on the face, changing up your visual environment is stimulating. I mean, like, recess should still be a thing. Yeah, because I think, you know, we all get stir crazy, and I, you know, believe in refreshing the air in our lungs.
Sure. Well, yeah. And it's super productive.
I
mean, even sleep. Some people are saying they're getting more sleep than others. Some people are having a hard time getting a sleep routine because the routine is just everything is so discombobulated.
Off.
But those moments of breaks are as important of those sustained moments of productive struggle, because in sleep, for example, your brain isn't actually dormant per se. It's incredibly active, And the science suggests that it's consolidating memories. It's helping to turn the experiences and the learning that you just went through, replaying those through your mind and building that into that long-term memory. So not only is it really fun to have recess, especially as a kid or as an adult, it's productive if it's always going to be everything is so routined to the point that breaks aren't happening and this holistic treatment of yourself is falling apart. You're also being unproductive with the learning.
I think remembering this time to take care of ourselves holistically, like emotionally, mentally, physically, get the blood moving, shake it up, go for walks, jog in place.
What do you think of, we're saying, take the message of hope that it's, we do want to take care of ourselves. That's priority number one, our health and our safety. On top of that, when we engage with school, we, however it is that your family does it or your school district is doing it, and they're all very different, is keeping in mind how we are as we help. It's not just how well we help, it's how we are as we help. And in doing that, we do want to have moments of sustained effort, sustained engagement. That's where the productive struggle really solidifies. I've heard some reports of external motivators. So people saying like, hey, if you do your math homework and get that done, then you can go play your video game or something to that effect.
It's a natural...
I don't know if you've heard any of those.
I was going to say, it's like, it's a natural instinct, I think, to start incentivizing that way. But yeah, it kind of makes me like, because you don't want school to feel like the medicine or the punishment. And I think, yeah, anything you can do to frame learning opportunities as something delightful and a treat, like, wow, we get to, you know, spend 20 minutes playing ST math or something. I don't exactly know how to do that all the time, but I guess
it's really hard because your kids are getting stir crazy. You're getting stir crazy.
Totally.
Kids are not used to this environment. They don't necessarily have the overall world awareness. And even though we do, it's hard for us. And when you're a kid, you want to jump and play and do those sorts of things. But I think it's really important as much as possible to avoid any of the external motivators because it makes the learning just feel like that's not really the human thing. That's not the stuff for us.
Yeah.
You feel forced into doing it. But also there's a lot of data that external motivators kill, like creative problem solving, productive, all the things that we want to build in through learning. The moment we come up with this random one-off motivator, if you do this, we'll do that. Those if-then rewards can really backfire. So my recommendation would be, if you do have kids that are, you're wanting to take a break or they're wanting to play a board game or they're wanting to play a video game, I think it's better to have a rule across the board of just saying, we play video games when our work is done. So you're building an expectation. You're building consistency. It's not one is a reward for the other.
It's
prioritizing.
Okay. It's a subtle shift.
It's that fine line. What do you think?
I think that's one. It's pretty subtle. I'm also wondering, I'm curious, you know, what other parents out there have done to try to avoid that, making breaks feel like a reward. I wonder if you just let them play that board game, but while you do it, like, there are lessons to be learned during it, or like, I'm sure you can tack on. Yeah. And I feel like maybe this is like other stuff we talk about in the future are like ways to just ask, like tack on questions and learning opportunities. How do you frame everyday activities into like, mathematical thinking problems or just like learning situations? There are plenty of insights and learning opportunities in video games or whatever. But of course, it's that balance. And I think it's also important to remember, like, while we're being, kind and compassionate to ourselves, you know, there's no right way of doing this. No one's ever been in this situation before. So it's more about finding what works best for the dynamics in your family.
Progress, not perfection.
Yeah. And we're all learning from each other. And I think we're really interested in hearing from, you know, everyone out there, what you're all doing, what works for you. And it's really just more of like a platter, like a smorgasbord of options, and just picking and choosing methods and strategies that work for your family to get you through this time in a productive, not even just productivity. I don't think it should be about productivity, but in like a cherishable time, you know?
Yeah. You don't have to be perfect. Mm-hmm. Kids aren't looking for that. They will see your personal growth, and they're going to learn from that in one way or the other. So, you know, I just, whatever it is, if we're like, oh, we've been doing these external motivators, or, oh, we've been really stressed out, that's fine. Mm-hmm. It's, you don't have to be perfect today or tomorrow or the next day or really ever.
Yeah.
But applying some of these lessons and improving, because, you know, there's a fair likelihood that for most of the people listening in, mm-hmm. we're probably not going back to the physical school this year.
Right.
And which is like, oh boy.
Not normal. None of this is normal.
Building this journey of growth ourselves.